I'm John Morris, the director of the Ronald W. Reagan Society, and happy Fall of the Wall to you. I hope you were able to participate in our stunning and really emotional ceremony with the students carrying the flags earlier tonight. It's a great reminder of the cause of freedom, and also a prideful moment, I think, for all of us here at Eureka College. So on behalf of President J. David Arnold and all of us at the college, welcome to this special presentation tonight of our keynote speaker for Fall of the Wall ceremony, who has generously agreed to give a full presentation that is centered on the leadership lesson at the core of one of the most significant meetings of leaders that has happened certainly within my lifetime and within our generations, Reagan and Gorbachev at Reykjavik, Iceland. Our speaker tonight was present because he was the director of U.S. Arms Control and Disarmament. His extraordinary career, as some of you may have heard earlier tonight, has had him all over the world, has had him in positions with the United Nations as UN ambassador, and really second to legendary Ambassador Jeanne Kirkpatrick. And when President Reagan called him to the White House team to be the director of U.S. Arms Control, a position that existed prior to him and after, but he was there at the most momentous time. Just a point of personal privilege, I lived in Washington, D.C. at the time of the third summit between Ronald Reagan and Mikhail Gorbachev, which is where the historic accords for nuclear arms reductions were signed in Washington, D.C. And at the time, I was a student, and my fellow students and I lined the sidewalks of 20th Street, where the Zeal limousine of Mikhail Gorbachev, which had been shipped over here because they didn't trust our limousines, and a massive motorcade larger than anything we had ever conceived of. And when you live in Washington, D.C., you see a lot of these motorcades. Was set to come through, and thousands of us lined 20th Street that day as the limo carrying Mikhail Gorbachev slowly drove through. And in a very strange emotional reaction, the students that day erupted into cheers and applause for the leader of the evil empire, the Soviet Union. And I remember at the time, it was such a strange reaction. Why were we cheering? We were cheering, as I've come to understand, the older I get, for what Ambassador Ken Adelman was working on. We were cheering for the accords that would lead to a greater peace, less of a threat of a ridiculous and insane policy of mutually assured destruction, which was then the outlook of the Soviet and U.S. leadership, or had been prior to Ronald Reagan. And so it's really a special privilege to hear tonight from a man who was there at Reykjavik in the second summit in which the world was changed. The title of his book is Reagan at Reykjavik, 48 Hours That Changed the World. And what you're about to hear tonight, and I've had the privilege of hearing and bits and pieces before, but I think will give you a perspective on leadership unlike anything you have ever seen. So without further introduction, which I could certainly make because his qualifications are many, let's hear from Ambassador Ken Adelman. Welcome to Eureka College.
Thank you. Thank you. I told you, John, that your introduction should be no more than 45 or 50 minutes. So try to cut it down, to something like that. But it's wonderful to be here. And I think your ceremony of the Fall of the Wall is just spectacular. And congratulations for doing that and being the only institution to do that. And for thinking of a kickoff of leadership studies centered at Eureka College and centered on Ronald Reagan. And so I hope to be the first to launch this whole thrust of using the college and using the experience of your most illustrious alumni to teach about leadership lessons. So I'm going to do that, and I put this together, four leadership lessons of the summit at Reykjavik. And to tell you right away, the leadership lessons are five. One is we just saw on the wall right next door, which is make no small plans. They lack the real magic to fire people's souls. That was Daniel Burnham's, the great architect's. That's his point, and it's a wonderful, wonderful point. Second is work out how to get to where your goals are so that you're not just spouting, here's where we want to be, but give us some kind of implementation, some kind of standard of going to that. Number three is trust your team. Pick a good team and trust the team. And Ronald Reagan did that very, very nicely, as we'll see. Next to last is don't accept defeat. That things can seem, and the Reykjavik summit seemed like a total failure, and Ronald Reagan had the personality and the optimism to bounce back from it and to really go and say that, no, we weren't defeated. That was a setback, but we're on our path. And lastly, it is to stay the course, that he was determined on what he wanted to accomplish, and he would not budge from that. To give you a minute of background, before Ronald Reagan came to office, the world was very fearful of nuclear weapons and of the whole standoff between the United States and the Soviet Union on nuclear weapons. When I was on the south side of Chicago, as we talked about at dinner, I went to grammar school, Bryn Mawr Grammar School, actually where Michelle Obama went many years later. And at Tuesday morning at 10:30 in the morning, we were marched down the hall, we got on our little knees, and we put our heads in the locker. And because of the fear of Soviet missile attack. I remember asking our principal, Miss Mulroy, how do we know that the Soviets are going to attack at 10:30 on Tuesday morning, Chicago time? And she said no, that the superintendent had worked all that out. And I remember asking Miss Mulroy, I said, my head's in the locker, I understand, but my fanny's still in the hall, so isn't that going to be fried? And she says, no, if your head is in the locker, your fanny will be fine. And lastly, don't ask any more questions, Ken. So, and as John was saying, there was enormous public outcry. This is a picture of, John, you were talking about that. When I was ambassador to the United Nations, there were something like 1.5 million, almost 2 million people in Central Park protesting the nuclear policies of Ronald Reagan and the nuclear standoff and advocating for a freeze. And this was higher than any anti-Vietnam protests that had come along. In 1963, the man of the year was really men of the year, and Andropov, the general secretary of the Soviet Union, and Reagan. And this was Reagan's second appearance as man of the year on Time magazine. And they were kind of back to back, like they were going to have a duel, but instead of pistols, they were going to use nuclear missiles. 1983 was a momentous year, as the year I became arms control director. It had the March 23rd speech for Strategic Defense Initiative. It had the deployment of missiles in Europe that were scheduled, had been scheduled since the Carter administration. It had the shoot down of the Korean airliner, and it was also the year that Ronald Reagan said that the Soviet Union was the evil empire, the center of evil in the modern world. And so it really was a very, very tense time. To back up for a minute, before he became president, Ronald Reagan had worked out how things were going to end. And it's a remarkable thing that one of the wonderful parts about doing this book was you learn so much that I didn't know at the time. I didn't know at the time that actually when Ronald Reagan was flying into Detroit to accept the nomination of the party to be president, he was on the plane, and Stu Spencer, his old-time political advisor, finally said to him, "Well, Ron, why are you doing this? Why do you want to be president?" Reagan said, "To end the Cold War." Well, none of us ever thought that the Cold War is going to end. We thought it would go on forevermore. And not only did Ronald Reagan devote himself and say that he was wanted to be president to end the Cold War, but he knew how the Cold War was going to end. And he said it quite a bit. He said, "It's going to end because we win and they lose." All right? And he had worked all this out. Then he had a series of Soviet leaders. Do you remember he came into office and Brezhnev was still in office? And then soon thereafter, in 82, Brezhnev died. And Andropov, who we saw in that picture, took over. Then Andropov died and Chernyenko took over. Then in March of 85, Chernyenko died. Ronald Reagan was asked why he didn't meet with the Soviet leaders, and he said, "Because they keep dying on me. How am I supposed to meet with them when they keep dying?" We were very good friends with the Italian ambassador at the time, and he told me that he was going to go over for Chernyenko's funeral. And I said, "You're doing what?" And he said, "I'm going over for Chernyenko's funeral." And I said, "Why are you doing that?" He says, "You don't understand, Ken. I bought tickets to the entire series." So I said, "Okay." In March of 1985, Mikhail Gorbachev comes to office. And he is young, he is vigorous, and he is obviously very bright. So it's kind of a new phenomenon to have a Soviet leader that did not have to be propped up with two people carrying him into the room, that didn't have to have a mirror under his nostrils to see if there was any breath there, and somebody who is very capable. At that, in 1985, that Gorbachev and Reagan met for the first time. And this was, we had spent 6 months planning for this summit. And both sides wanted it in a neutral situation. It's a neutral country, Switzerland. Neutral city, Geneva, even a neutral place, not the United States or the Soviet embassy or consulate. It was in a chateau of Aga Khan. And it was going to be totally neutral. The trouble was, and the main part of the summit was, all that was blown away the first minute of the summit by Ronald Reagan. You have to remember, Ronald Reagan is now 75 years old. Mikhail Gorbachev is something like 54 at that time. Gorbachev's a younger generation. Reagan is thought to be a little doddering in his old age. He had been shot and nearly died. Gorbachev is very vigorous. And we were worried that Reagan couldn't keep up with this. I was standing with a group in the Aga Khan's hallway. When talking to President Reagan, he was talking about, I don't know, horseback riding and something. And all of a sudden, a Secret Service guy comes up to him, said, "Mr. President, Mikhail Gorbachev, the General Secretary, is coming around the bend in his car." In 1 minute, Ronald Reagan blew apart the whole idea of the summit being equal and totally neutral. The Chief of Staff of the White House explained what happened right here.
"We were waiting for General Secretary Gorbachev to arrive. President Reagan was waiting inside the mansion. He had no coat on. He was asked, did he want to put a coat on? And while he was trying to make up his mind, the Secret Service announced that Gorbachev was there. So Reagan said, my heavens. He raced out the door without his overcoat, down the steps, and just as Gorbachev's limousine door opened, there was Reagan with his hand out, ready to greet him. Gorbachev was bundled up in a muffler, hat, overcoat. Reagan then put his hand under Gorbachev's arm and assisted him up the stairs."
It was an amazing kind of thing for this older man to kind of help him just in case he he missed his footing or something like that, this bundled up little man. And then what was so wonderful about it was the head of communications of the Soviet Union, the main spokesman of the Soviet Union, knew what had just happened.
I felt that we lost the game during this first movement. You can compare it with a chess game. We started with the wrong move.
I love that, on his admission on that. So the next year was the Reykjavik summit. It was a come-as-you-are summit. We had spent 6 months on preparing for Geneva. Gorbachev proposed the summit in something like 14 days, and so we scrambled. It was not going to be a summit. It was just going to be a meeting between the two. There were not going to be big staffs, or it was not going to be a lot of hoopla, and it was just going to be a discussion set up for the real summit that was going to be in Washington in December. But here is Ronald Reagan in cartoon. Well, Mick, I see you're all set for our low-key, one-on-one, non-summit. He has absolutely no staff with him. We were very lucky. We had very few staff with us. And Mikhail Gorbachev is there, and he brought 300 people in his party. Iceland was very remote, and a city of 125,000 in a country of 250,000, totally ill-equipped for it to be the centerpiece of the world in a weekend. They had something like 150 or something international phone lines. They had no satellite beaming to the beaming stations to get pictures out or anything like that. And all of a sudden, they are the centerpiece of the world at that time. They did have one thing, however. Just a month before the summit, Miss Iceland had been named Miss World. And so she was over in Singapore on a goodwill tour and called to come back to for the summit. And there she is. I thought that would make a great cover of my book, to tell you the truth. We could name it 50 Shades of Grey in Iceland or something like that to just capitalize on that market. And but they thought that was a little off key on it. Nancy Reagan was told that Raisa Gorbachev would not attend the Reykjavik summit. The two had been together in Geneva and had found less than many things to admire about each other. And basically, they really didn't like each other. The Reykjavik experience really didn't help that relationship because the Mrs. Reagan was told that Mrs. Gorbachev would not be there. So she decided to keep it a business meeting and non-summit. And the door of the plane opened in Reykjavik. And there was Raisa Gorbachev. Just like Mikhail Gorbachev was a new type of Soviet leader, Raisa Gorbachev was a new type of first lady. Someone said she was the first lady of Soviet history, for example, to weigh less than her husband, which was something. And she certainly was well-dressed and very fashionable and very sharp. She had a PhD, although in Marxist philosophy, but still really took the place by storm. She wanted to visit cultural sites. She asked for a list of cultural sites. The first day of the summit, she visited 8 cultural sites in Reykjavik, which were about, I figured, about 4 more than Reykjavik ever had to offer. And then she ran around on the second day as well. There was a total press blackout of the summit, so that could be no news from what was happening behind closed doors at that time. All these news organizations from around the world had sent representatives. We said it was going to be a low-key affair, a non-summit, that press wasn't going to care that much. That was totally wrong as well. By the time the summit opened, there were 3,175 accredited journalists there for the summit. Each of these journalists had represented a news organization, and the news organization had spent a lot of money getting them to Reykjavik, which is hard to get to, schlepping all their equipment to Reykjavik, and they needed some stories of what was happening there. With a total news blackout of the summit, Rais of Gorbachev became the only story in town. And boy, did she love it. She was very happy. The day before the summit opened, everybody wanted to give a setting for the summit and all. I'm using the word summit, but it was, like I told you, a non-summit. But and so they called up the prime minister's office in Reykjavik to say that they'd like to do a interview. Tom Brokaw of NBC News did that. And they said, when would the prime minister of Iceland be available for an interview? And the prime minister's office said, whenever Tom Brokaw can do it, we'll do it. So they picked a time on Friday morning where the prime minister normally has his hot water bath, his thermal springs, and they did it right there. So I think it is the only interview that was broadcast around the world with a prime minister in his Speedo. And his press guy is standing right there to the right. And you wonder what he's doing for a living. Why, how about a towel? How about a bathrobe? How about some kind of dress on this? But they proceeded to do the interview on the side of the summit with the, you know, the prime minister in his flab and his little Speedo right there. Reagan that afternoon on Friday, the day before the summit opened, called on the president of Iceland, who was the first female elected president in the world. And she said, it was wonderful to meet him. Instead of just sitting and talking, why don't they go out and take a walk together? And so they walked around the presidential grounds right there. She's a very nice lady who just came to Washington. I saw her 2 months ago. The amazing part of this photo is not only they're walking around the two presidents, but Ronald Reagan's coat. It's just like something from the 30s movie or something. It's the only time that weekend I saw him in this coat, and it's the only time anybody's ever seen him in the coat. So where the coat came from and what he was doing wearing it, I was at the Reagan Library giving this talk about a year ago, and they had five people who do photographs at the Reagan Library. And I said, I will give up $50 to anybody who finds a photograph of Reagan in this coat in any other situation than him taking a walk with it. And I haven't heard from anybody. So it's just kind of freaky. One of the wonderful things about Reykjavik was, of course, the setting where it was. It's not just at Reykjavik, but they chose the Hofti House. Hofti House was built in 1909. It's a beautiful, beautiful structure in this totally remote, totally out of the way city, in this totally remote, totally out of the way on the Arctic Circle country of Iceland, is this totally remote and totally out of the way Hofti House. It was owned by the British government until the 40s, and the British ambassador said it was haunted, that he heard ghosts, that he saw ghosts, and they wanted to get rid of it. So it is even today not called Hofti House. It is called the Haunted House by the neighbors on that. This is where the meetings took place. And the meetings over that weekend, and the weekend was October 11th and 12th, 1986, that Reagan met with Gorbachev 10 and a half hours. Now, I don't know about you, but I haven't talked to my wife for 10 and a half hours over a weekend in my life. And this is without notes, without talking points, without memos. And usually a president and a general secretary of the Soviet Union, any leader, is so scripted and so controlled that, you know, they just follow the script. Here, the two men were just flying solo. And I think, and I've said, and I really do believe, that they were more like themselves than at any other time in office. They could say and do what they wanted, unencumbered by the staff all around them. To give you that's how small the Hofti House is compared to the car right there. I'll give you a quick tour. On the upper right was the Russian parlor. It's an old bedroom. On the, on the upper left was the American parlor where we were, and the president came up from the meeting room to meet us up there. Between the two was the DMZ, the Demilitarized Zone. Like between North and South Korea, or East and West Germany at that time, on that. Then the left-hand room was where the two of them met, and you'll see that in a minute, how small it is. And the most wonderful thing about the Hofty House that I only saw on the second day was the basement. The basement was fabulous. And it, you can see it was kind of small, but the basement had one half of it was filled with KGB and the equipment of the General Secretary of the Soviet Union. The other half was filled by the CIA and the White House communications with all their gear up to the ceiling. The basement had two bathrooms, one bigger than the other, unfortunately. I say unfortunately because when the hurry-up summit was hurried up and set, each side wanted to claim the best bathroom. And so they went back and forth and back and forth, and finally the head of the KGB said, oh, just we'll see what happens and just leave it go. We don't have to specify one bathroom for one group for the KGB or one group for the CIA. So what I like to say is that while intelligence agencies from around the world operate on a need-to-know basis, the two main intelligence agencies from the world operated that weekend on a need-to-go basis. That was the Hofty House. Like I say, it was thought to be haunted. Here is a cartoon at the time. You think that this house is haunted, you should see the place next door, which was the arms race that was quite heated at that time. At 10 o'clock on Saturday morning, October 11th, 1986, the two of them met in front of the Hofty House. They then went to the small room, and there they started discussing no small plans. They wanted to really reduce nuclear weapons substantially, Gorbachev and Reagan being the first leaders of their country, not to do arms control, which would permit increases in their arsenals, but to do real reductions on both sides. We thought that was when Ronald Reagan gave his speech here in 1982 at Eureka College. He was proposing to, for the first time ever in history, to really reduce nuclear weapons. You have to understand SALT I, SALT II, the Nixon and Carter, and Nixon, Ford, and Carter proposals were all to limit the growth of nuclear weapons. Reagan came in and he said, that's not for me, I want real reductions. And the criticism, and you can see it in the Ronald Reagan Museum there, John, where people are going after Reagan saying that's unrealistic, you don't understand the Soviet Union. People like Senator Kennedy and Muskie are quoted in that article on the wall, that Reagan said, I want reductions, that's why we're going to change it from SALT, Strategic Arms Limitations Talk, to START, Strategic Arms Reduction Talk. So it was going to be real reductions on that. When they are in this room, they meet and find out they both have big plans for the weekend. And after that time, George Shultz says that we should all gather in the bubble afterwards, and he'll tell us what happened. Now, you have to understand, a bubble is a room within a room that appears in every embassy around the world. Walls are about this thick. They have all kinds of material on the walls, including kind of steel, that makes them impenetrable to a intelligence agency on the other side. So they're totally secure. You can have absolute security in it. And the bubble we had in Germany, or in Geneva for the talks, could seat about 25 around the table, and then we would latch it closed and know that we were in there secure. The Reykjavik had the smallest bubble ever made because nothing ever happened in Iceland and none of it was ever classified. So we got in the bubble waiting for Shultz to come in. The chairs were a little more narrower than these chairs. There were four on one side and four on the other. We were shoulder to shoulder on that. And our knees were knee, and it was closed. As we were in the bubble, and George Shultz was telling us what was happening on that. All of a sudden, we're in the bubble, and Ronald Reagan walks in. And the door opens, Reagan walks in, and you can see that he says, this is a reenactment that was done by BBC after the Reykjavik summit, and Reagan says, this is so small we should use it as an aquarium after, fill it up with water and everything. And I was in the bubble, and I didn't have a seat because I let the president have my seat because there were eight of us in the bubble already. President comes in. I said, right here, Mr. President. I hit the ground, and for the next 40 minutes, I was gently leaning against the presidential knees on that. So he was telling us that this was going to be big stuff and a lot was going to happen at Reykjavik. Work out how to get there. Reagan had an idea of what he wanted on ending the Cold War. One part was, as I said, deep reductions in nuclear weapons. Another part was strategic defense initiative to protect the country from incoming ballistic missiles. A third part was delegitimizing the Soviet Union to say it wasn't a democracy, it wasn't legitimate. So that gave rise to the evil empire allegation and Reagan saying communism is going to end up on the ash heap of history. And so those were kind of principles of what he wanted. The last of the four elements was a big buildup of the U.S. military across the board so that the Soviets couldn't keep up and it would bankrupt them, in essence. The one thing that got Gorbachev up the wall was the delegitimization of the Soviet Union, saying it was going to end up on the ash heap of history and it was not a legitimate system. Only a system based on the will of the people was legitimate. And what got Gorbachev up the wall all weekend long was SDI, the Strategic Defense Initiative. Here's kind of a cartoon from the time where Gorbachev says, anyway, we don't think such a crazy thing could ever work. Got a light. Reagan contacts one of the SDI satellites and said, here's your light. And then Reagan says the Star Wars stuff drives him nuts. And you can see Reagan's little face there. That Gorbachev, as you'll see, one of the wonderful things doing the book was to find the transcripts of what Reagan and Gorbachev said for their 10 and a half hours. We have American notes and the Russian notes, both of from them. And you can see what Gorbachev says about SDI, which is quite spectacular. While they were discussing this, Raisa Gorbachev was racing around town giving a talk wherever she could, even at the hot thermal springs. She was there talking about world peace and all that, where all these people just wanted to bathe and swim instead. Saturday night of October 11th, Joan Baez was downtown giving a concert. While she was giving a concert downtown, we met again at the Hofty House. At 8 o'clock, this was without Reagan and Gorbachev, but the arms control team. We met at 8 o'clock at night. We took a break at 3:15 in the morning, and for a half hour, and we adjourned at 6:20 in the morning. In that, the next morning at 8 o'clock at night, while doing the all-nighter, I reported to the president that we had accomplished more in that one night than we had in 7.5 years negotiating with the Soviets in Geneva. And part of that was because of our team had its act together, and he trusted the team very nicely. Part of it was because the Soviet Union was led by Mikhail Gorbachev, who wanted deep reductions in nuclear weapons, even though he wanted to crash SDI. And part of it was that the person who was representing the Soviet Union in that all-night negotiations was an amazing man named Marshal Akhramayev, who was the chief of staff of the Soviet Union, five-star marshal. Our last five-star was Omar Bradley, and an amazing man that is here with the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff of the United States. Here is Akhramayev as he looked in Reykjavik. To give you just a quick summary, he had joined the army, the Soviet army, when he was 18 years old. He was born of a very poor mother who was a single parent, brought him up in order just to make a living. He joined the army. When he was in World War II, he was stationed outside of Stalingrad. He was told for 18 months to stay on that road to protect the road against the Nazi assaults, German assaults. He stayed on that road for 18 months without ever going inside. And the Russian winter got down to 22, 24 below zero. He had his pup tent right there. Most of his battalion was wiped out. He had shrapnel in his back and he lost hearing in his ear, but he stayed alive during that 18 months and protected the road from the Nazi invasion on that. I got to know him and I talked at the ceremony next door about how I was in Budapest for the fall of the wall and then went over to Soviet Union. I had found out at that time he was no longer chief of staff of the Soviet military. He had become an advisor, military advisor to Mikhail Gorbachev. So I wrote him a little note. I'm in town. You know, if you have time, I'd love to say hello to you. Wrote back immediately, come and I'd love to see you. He was on the third floor of the Kremlin, right down the hall from Gorbachev. And I walked in. This was in November of 89. Walked in his office, beautiful office. He showed me the office and he showed me his chandelier right there. I said, that's nice. And then we talked about the amazing changes taking place right then. Soviet Union starts to disintegrate in 1990. By 1991, it's clear that everything's breaking up. And in November, I think it was, of 1991, I'm reading the newspaper, Washington Post, about the amazing events in the Soviet Union after the coup attempt. Right there, 91, and buried in the fourth paragraph of the article about all the amazing things happening in the Soviet Union is the notice that Marshal Akhramayev committed suicide the night before in his office on that, hanging himself by that chandelier right there that he pointed out to me. As if nothing could get any worse, I read that. I called Colin Powell, who was then chairman of the Joint Chiefs. He couldn't believe it either. And as if nothing could be any worse, that he had a funeral, Akhramayev did, in a few days, and virtually no one came. His family, a few friends, he was in the rain. The most decorated man in Soviet history, a five-star marshal. And he was just buried in a normal cemetery without honors, without guns, without salutes. And 3 days later, his body was dug up and somebody stole his uniform on that. So it was just a inglorious and painful conclusion to a man who served his country well, even though I disagreed with his values on that. The summit, unlike any previous summit, went into overtime. It was supposed to end Sunday at noon. And this is a photo from Sunday afternoon. Ronald Reagan is sitting in the corner. He had come up Sunday afternoon, and he had said, this is going to be it. We have been here already 10 hours, and I promised Nancy I'd be home for dinner tonight. I was trying to be accommodating, and I said, Mr. President, she'll know where you are. It's not like you stopped at the bar on the way home from work or anything. He says, I know, but I told her I would be home for dinner. He didn't make it home for dinner. He made it home about midnight. Anyway, he just wanted to make one last offer to Mikhail Gorbachev. We worked out an offer that would preserve SDI, but really reduce nuclear weapons. Ronald Reagan left the room, and in another great leadership example, came back in the room after we all said, good luck, Mr. President. We knew it was going to be a big moment in his life. Big moment in our lives, a big moment in history, in the life of the country. He left the room. We all stood around kind of amazed. And all of a sudden he comes back. And we said, what is it? He said, I just want to make sure that we're doing right by America. I just want to make sure that our proposal isn't getting carried away by all the emotion that we're feeling, all that. And then he went around and asked people in the circle where we were standing, are you comfortable with this? And kind of taking a poll of everybody. And I thought in the middle of heated negotiations, it was a wonderful thing to do, to just make sure that we were thinking sensibly on that. Reagan then went down, and you can see George Shultz right there, Don Regan, President Poindexter, who is National Security Advisor, me before I started dyeing my hair white, and the back of the head of Richard Pearl on that. Reagan went down, made this proposal. Gorbachev wanted to crash and really stop SDI. We were in the room absolutely exhausted. I had gotten very little sleep Thursday night when we came in. Friday night, we were busy preparing all this. Saturday night, we did the all-nighter. So I figure I slept about 6 hours the previous three nights. And I was almost delirious on that. We were sitting there knowing it was awfully tense. And all of a sudden, the Secret Service guy busts in and says, they've broken. A very odd phrase. I didn't know what that meant. But we headed for the stairwell, we looked down, and you could see Ronald Reagan's face in the hallway, and he was mad. And Gorbachev walked him out to the car. Gorbachev stood there and said, well, I don't know, Ron, what we could have done differently. And Reagan plunged his finger into Gorbachev's chest and said, you could have said yes. And we went back to the ambassador's residence where Reagan was staying, and we couldn't talk to him because he was pacing back and forth, and he was furious. It was one of the two or three times I saw him in my life where he was just mad, really mad. And so we kind of kept away from him at that time. The word went out that Reykjavik was a terrible failure, and that Reagan blew the opportunity because he absolutely held tough on SDI on that. Reagan then got in his car, drove to Keflavik, which is the airport, and was also doubled as a NATO base. And it was scheduled to say hello to the troops out there for a few minutes. He was still furious on the 30-mile ride out to Keflavik, and he was until he stood up to the young men and women in uniform and their family in the hangars, and all of a sudden he became Ronald Reagan once again. Once he was in front of all those people, and he stood there and he thanked them for his service. He explained while he was late, he apologized for being late, that he had been in overtime, and he told a few stories about one of the stories, which is wonderful, I'd never heard it before, about when he became president, that he was bothered because he was told when he was in the service that you cannot salute unless you're in uniform. And so he talked to the commandant, it wasn't PX Kelly, but it was right before that, and he told the commandant of the Marines, he says, you know, I know that rule, but there is no uniform for a commander in chief. And I'm just wondering, I want to salute, and I'm just wondering if it's okay. And can't you change the regulations or something so I can do that? And the commandant at that point said, Mr. President, if you salute, I don't think anybody will mind. And so from that time on, every time he could, it was that he would be salute. Reagan would not accept defeat. Everybody else called it a failure. He said, let's build on it. And the fact is that it was a milestone, not only because the two men wanted to reduce nuclear weapons, but the lesson was absolutely clear, that Ronald Reagan was willing to sit down with the Soviets, but Ronald Reagan was willing to stand up to the Soviets as well, and was not going to get carried away doing something that wasn't in our national security interest because it was a summit that had to succeed. And I think that was a lesson that Gorbachev really never forgot and decided this was a lot tougher guy than he seems because he was so nice. Then, as you know, as you hear today, the next episode is, of course, at the Brandenburg Gate, and where Reagan does this amazing speech that you heard about and addresses the people in a way that is fabulous. Then, in December, we're working all year. In December, the Gorbachevs come to Washington to sign the agreement. Nancy Reagan and Raisa Gorbachev are together for the first time since Geneva. Nancy was pretty steamed up when Raisa was running around Reykjavik. And you can see in the welcoming ceremony, their wonderful, warm welcome to each other and how really affectionate they feel towards each other. But the men did feel towards each other while they signed the INF agreement, eliminating an entire class of nuclear weapons for the first time in history. This was done in the East Room of the White House. You can see here is Akhramayev right there. The second row is kind of in the cabinet, and Schultz and the Vice President Bush and everybody in the first row. Second row is kind of interesting. It's a mix of KGB and CIA that were then getting along because they had shared the bathroom so nicely. And the third row was the kind of worker bees. You can see Colin Powell there, Paul Nitze, myself, Max Kampelman, and others. But it was a great, great day. And what it signified was the start of a real reductions in nuclear weapons that can be traced to Reykjavik. And I think it's quite clear when you look at the totals of the USSR-Russia, that Reykjavik was the high water mark of that. And the US had been going a little steady, and then after Reykjavik, certainly reduced our nuclear weapons quite dramatically. That was in 1987. I was out of government at 2 days after Gorbachev left. I signed the agreement and left town. And in the summer of 1988, Ronald Reagan went to Moscow like an Old Testament preacher talking about the virtues of free enterprise and freedom. That here he is at Moscow University under the 6-foot Lenin and the hammer and sickle. Reagan's talking about freedom and how that the Soviet system is on its last legs and will die. I love that between the two pillars, Reagan right there. He was in Moscow for 4 days. The last night after a state dinner that Gorbachev gave him in the Kremlin, after the Bolshoi Ballet, he is seen going around Red Square, and a press guy goes up to him and says, "My God, why are you here?" And he says, "Well, because we're leaving in the morning, and I didn't want Nancy to miss this sight." And so he took her there, and I love that photo of them right in Red Square. I mentioned this afternoon that I heard about the fall of the wall in Hungary. It was in the main square in Hungary where they had the monument right there to the Soviet troops that had liberated Hungary. In 1989, of course, we know today that the wall fell. I told you about Rostakovich running there, says, "All I need is a chair." He was given a chair and he plays the cello for 2 hours with the wall in back of him. And the next year, on the last year of his life, Leonard Bernstein goes and he has the Ode to Joy on this wonderful, wonderful combination of East Germans, West Germans, French, British, Americans, and Soviets. And I would never imagine in that square that I had heard so much in Budapest would now be occupied by a wonderful, larger-than-life statue of Ronald Reagan and with a plaque that says, you know, for giving us our freedom back on that. By 1990, the Soviet Union is really tottering. Yeltsin wants to take Russia out of the Soviet Union, and the signs are on there that the whole idea of the Soviet Union will be over because all the republics have been really withdrawn from the Union. On Christmas Day, the flag, the hammer and sickle come down from the top of the Kremlin, and Ronald Reagan's prediction comes true. Just a great, great day when the flag came down. That was 1991. 1994, the doctors tell President Reagan that he has been suffering of late, and he had been suffering because of Alzheimer's disease. Without much hesitation, as John well knows because we talked about it, without much hesitation, Ronald Reagan takes out from his desk drawer a piece of stationery, and he writes the last communications that he has to the American people. The great communicator ends his communications with a letter to the American people explaining what is happening.
November 5th, 1994. My fellow Americans, I have recently been told that I am one of the millions of Americans who will be afflicted with Alzheimer's disease. Unfortunately, as Alzheimer's disease progresses, the family often bears a heavy burden. I only wish there was some way I could spare Nancy from this painful experience. When the time comes, I am confident that with your help, she will face it with faith and courage. In closing, let me thank you, the American people, for giving me the great honor of allowing me to serve as your president. When the Lord calls me home, whenever that may be, I will leave the greatest love for this country of ours and eternal optimism for its future. I now begin the journey that will lead me into the sunset of my life. I know that for America, there will always be a bright dawn ahead. Thank you, my friends. Sincerely, Ronald Reagan.
It's a beautiful, beautiful thing. 2 years later, at the 10th anniversary of the Reykjavik summit, the Iceland government invites the participants back. And we were there for 2 days, like the summit itself. And during that time, I felt an overwhelming emotion going to our parlor on the second floor, seeing where the two men met, going through the basement where the equipment of the KGB and the CIA were stacked up, just seeing the Soviet parlor on that, visiting the bubble once again. I just felt an emotion like nothing I'd ever felt before. And it was the knowledge that Reagan was going through this very hard time. And one day out of the two, when I was walking back from the Hofty House to the hotel, I stopped at a drugstore and I got a postcard. And even though I didn't know the address where I was sending this, I wrote out a postcard just like that postcard and sent it, mailed it that day. The week later, I was at the Reagan Library for a conference on Reykjavik, and down the hall I see Mrs. Reagan coming. So I went up to her and I said, "Mrs. Reagan, I was just in Reykjavik." She said, "I know, Maureen told me that you were there with her." And how was it? And I said, "Well, Mrs. Reagan, I want to tell you, I sent your husband a postcard." She says, "You did what?" I said, "I sent him a postcard." She looked at me like, you know, kind of aggravated and thinking that he couldn't read a postcard anymore. And I was kind of I don't know, embarrassed or moved by that. And I said, well, and she says, well, what'd you say? I said, well, I can't remember exactly what I said, but I'll tell you what the thrust was. It was, Mr. Dear President Reagan, I'm back here at the 10th anniversary of the Reykjavik summit, thinking of the wonderful job you did on behalf of our country and how very proud I was to serve you 10 years ago. Sincerely, Ken Adelman. And I mailed it. Then she, Nancy Reagan, burst out in tears, and I got very weepy at that. And we shared a very special moment for really a very special guy. A few years after that, of course, what Nancy Reagan called the long goodbye finally went goodbye. There was an outpouring of emotion in the country on the funeral, and the whole ceremonies. Carol and I were lucky to be invited to the cathedral to see the official funeral, and we're very, very moved by it. But the main thing over those days that really moved me was the appearance of a plane, unannounced and unanticipated, at Washington National Airport, now called Ronald Reagan Washington National Airport. And out of the plane emerges Mikhail Gorbachev. He goes immediately up to the Capitol, where the body was in waiting. He's recognized, he's allowed to come inside the honor guard right there. And he walks up, he sees the coffin, he spends a minute thinking about all the experiences they had together. Then he goes up and rubs his hand up and down the stars and stripes of the flag on top of the coffin of the 40th President of the United States. After that time, Gorbachev is asked probably hundreds of times, you came in office, the Cold War was at the coldest, got worse in 1983, 84, 85. You came in, it was absolutely cold. You left, the Cold War was virtually over. What changed? And he always gives the same answer, Reykjavik. Reykjavik changed everything. And he must have been thinking about how at Reykjavik they had no small plan, how at Reykjavik they really did trust their team, how they, at least Reagan, had the steps to implement what he wanted. Neither of them really gave up on anything. And they decided that they really were going to be not transactional leaders in the world, but transformational leaders in the world. And both of them were. I thank you very much for the little story of Reykjavik. Thank you. Questions? Comments? Yeah, please.
Well, first of all, thank you,
Professor
for your
Sanders.
Presentation.
Good.
I really enjoyed them. As a historian, I like primary sources. Not written, but now in person. Mm-hmm.
That was at the summit before that in Geneva, and by the time they got back to Reykjavik, they were calling, Reagan didn't call him anything, but he kept saying Mr. President on that. And Reagan didn't call him anything because Reagan, for a man who was in the public world, first in Hollywood and then in politics, was amazingly bad at names. And he really wasn't very up quick. Names, and so I think he just stayed away from calling anybody by name, to tell the truth. So according to the Russian notes and the American notes at Reykjavik, he really didn't use any title. Yeah, please.
Where is that summit blood ice land? Where is it open
to the public? Yeah, the Hofty House is open to the public, and they have a guest book that has Reagan and Gorbachev at the top and all members of the delegation right there. And you can see where the two of them met. You can see where the parlors were in the basement that was crowded right there. And they have pictures in there of that weekend. Please.
Yeah, we've been to Reykjavik, and you are correct. It's out in the middle of nowhere.
Oh, my God.
And one of the poor guys lives over there. Well, he was saying that when they came, they brought the KGB and the CIA, and they asked what kind of security they have. And they say, well, we have none. There's nothing here but
Well, I don't know how good the Boy Scouts were either, to tell you the truth. The fact is, it's an amazing country. They have no guns. The police don't have guns. The army is non-existent. They don't have guns. So the only guns that weekend were a lot of KGB guns and some Secret Service. But otherwise, there are no guns in the country. There's no railroad in the country. There were, at that time, very few. Well, they started getting cars in the 30s and 40s, but relatively few roads. So it really was an amazing kind of place to hold this. The reason it was held there is that Gorbachev wanted a place that was midway between Washington and Moscow. And he proposed two places midway, London and Reykjavik. President Reagan said, oh, the trouble with London is, if we go there, I have to meet with Maggie Thatcher, I have to meet with the Queen, I have to talk to the Parliament, I got all that stuff I got to do. If we go to Reykjavik, we don't have to do anything. He had a half-hour walk with the President of Iceland, and that was about it. So it was just easier to meet there, especially when they figured it wasn't going to be much of anything for that. One more question, and then I have a real treat for you that I put together for Eureka College. Anything? Okay, our treat is, and this is a extra credit bonus for you, this is the 1981 inauguration address of Ronald Reagan put together with some slides that I found. I think you'll enjoy this.
If we look to the answer as to why for so many years we achieved so much, prospered as no other people on earth, it was because here in this land we unleashed the energy and individual genius of man to a greater extent than has ever been done before. Freedom and the dignity of the individual have been more available and assured here than in any other place on earth. The price for this freedom at times has been high, but we have never been unwilling to pay that price. Those who say that we're in a time when there are no heroes, they just don't know where to look. The sloping hills of Arlington National Cemetery, with its row upon row of simple white markers bearing crosses or stars of David, they add up to only a tiny fraction of the price that has been paid for our freedom. Each one of those markers is a monument to the kind of hero I spoke of earlier. Their lives ended in places called Belleau Wood, the Argonne, Omaha Beach, Salerno, and halfway around the world on Guadalcanal, Tarawa, Porkchop Hill, the Chosin Reservoir, and in 100 rice paddies and jungles of a place called Vietnam. Under one such marker lies a young man, Martin Treptow, who left his job in a small town barber shop in 1917 to go to France with the famed Rainbow Division. There on the Western Front, he was killed trying to carry a message between battalions under heavy artillery fire. We're told that on his body was found a diary. On the flyleaf, under the heading My Pledge, he had written these words: America must win this war. Therefore, I will work, I will save, I will sacrifice, I will endure. I will fight cheerfully and do my utmost as if the issue of the whole struggle depended on me alone. We must realize that no arsenal or no weapon in the arsenals of the world is so formidable as the will and moral courage of free men and women. It is a weapon our adversaries in today's world do not have. It is a weapon that we as Americans do have. Let that be understood by those who practice terrorism and prey upon their neighbors. As for the enemies of freedom, those who are potential adversaries, they will be reminded that peace is the highest aspiration of the American people. We will negotiate for it, sacrifice for it. We will not surrender for it now or ever. We are Americans.
Thank you very much.
Ambassador Adelman, you are marvelous. Thank you for the story of Reagan at Reykjavik and the leadership lessons, which I think we will all take to heart. And thank you for the special tribute video, a bonus for Eureka College. Ambassador Adelman is an author, and he has a book. Actually, he's got six books he's written, but he's got the one he's lectured on tonight. And he will be available to sign books. Books are available for sale in the bookstore right outside the door. Turn the lights up a little bit. We've got a signing table right over there. So if anybody would like to have Ambassador Adelman sign a book, or you can sit there,
yeah,
sure. Or simply just meet him and say hello.
I'd like that.
Please do. So on behalf of the Ronald W. Reagan Society, thank you for coming. I want to especially thank Mike Mangold and Mangold Ford, who is our lead sponsor for Fall of the Wall. Once again, I thanked him earlier, but please help me thank Mike Mangold, who's here with us tonight. In addition, PNC has been a great supporter of our speaker series. So without them, we could not do what we do. Thanks so much for coming. God bless you all. And Ken Adelman, you're part of the family now, like I said earlier. Take care.
Thanks.